Good morning.
Good morning.
It's nice to see so many of you in church today, and the gloves are off in every way this morning. it's nice, no masks. Oh, aren't we sick of masks? And do you still have to wear masks in stores? So even that is off.
They have the authority within the premises.
So the store can ask you to wear a mask.
Municipalities have their authority.
Right. We got a message this week from Uganda. They are in another lockdown. They are shot if they are found in the street. If they go out to look for food, they are shot. There's no questions asked. They are in full lockdown in Uganda. They can get escorts to get money and food. And we got a plea this last week from Uganda, from Kakir, the principal of the school. He has, I think there's 11 teachers and one security guard, and they are all they haven't had work for a month and a half now because of these lockdowns. And they're literally, I'm actually getting notes saying, we're hungry, please help. I'm not good at saying no. I don't know how to say, I'm sorry, I can't help you. I don't know how to do that. And so you at home, if you have a few extra bucks, please send it here. We are box 1078, Sundry, Alberta, T0M1X0. And we will be sending that money away very soon to try to get more money to them. We sent $800 this past week, which is an awful lot of money in Uganda. So that was able to pay everything and food for 11 families. About $100 a month feeds a family in Uganda. And rent of the house that we have for the one main family is $170 a month. And that's an enclosed home with walls and guards and a big steel fence. And a salary in Uganda per month is about $50. That's what the teachers earn, about 50 bucks. And you heard me say it's $100 to feed them, right? So that means that the mom and the dad have to have a teaching certificate. That's not a degree. And so they go for a few months instead of a few years. And then they're allowed to teach. So that's what we're dealing with right now with the pandemic over there. We apparently have survived it, and I hope and pray and pray and pray, and I do, that this will not start up again. I can see the Calgary Stampede being a kind of a breeding ground that will really cause all sorts of trouble. I hope it doesn't, but there's going to be so many people rubbing shoulders. I hope it doesn't start another lockdown on our part too. But anyways, with that all in mind, I remind you that today is the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. It is Communion Sunday here in Sundry. And we will be thinking a lot today about our other organist, Laura Clausen, who is in the hospital. Does anybody have details on what it's about? I have phoned and phoned and phoned, and I cannot get any information on Laura.
No, Denise said that she would call and let us know more when they knew more. But at this point, they have no idea what's the matter with her.
Well, what?
They're running tests.
Well, what sent her in there? What happened to her?
She was short of breath and tired, and apparently they sent her into the hospital here from there. I'm guessing they sent her to Red Deer. She has blood clots on the lung.
Wow.
And she needed a blood transfusion.
Oh,
now,
wow.
Why she needed the blood transfusion, I don't know.
So it's a lot more serious than just tired and blood clots.
Yeah, the blood clots on the lung.
Well, Laura, if you're listening this morning, or Laura's family, if you're listening this morning, please know that we are praying for you, and we sure hope and pray that you get better. I'm looking at myself in the phone this morning because I can see myself. Do you all see this big lump on the side of my face? It was my grandson's birthday yesterday, and he got a whole bunch of new toys. And one of them was a table that a leg goes into, and I put the wrong leg into the wrong hole. But then I had to pull it out again. So I grabbed the table and I grabbed the leg, and I was pulling with all my might. When it let go, and I banged myself right in the head. And years ago, when I was a prison guard, I got knocked out. I got hit with a 2x4 by a guy from the back of my head. And so when I get hit now, I see stars right away, and I hit myself, and I was leaning over on the couch, and I could see stars, and my grandson looked at me and said, "Are you okay, Grandpa?" I said, no, I'm not okay. And so now I have this big lump, so I must look in rough shape. I have half a tooth and a lump on the top of my head. Rocky Marciano's got nothing over me. Okay. We will begin our worship service this morning in the name of the Father, in the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The brief order for confession and forgiveness is found up on the screen and in your bulletin. Let us begin. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open and all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth isn't in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved you as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we will delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, you are forgiven. Amen. Opening hymn today is from the Red Hymnal 863. Number 863, if you at home have it, it's called My God, How Wonderful. If you look up in your own hymnals, My God, How Wonderful, 863. And I don't know a lot of these hymns, so...
And forbears as
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Think we can shake hands?
Absolutely.
And I'd ask you all to rise and turn to your neighbor and offer your neighbor the peace of the Lord. Peace be with you at home. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Not having the whatever.
No.
It's on the bulletin. That's the bulletin.
Peace be with you, Jenny. Peace be with you. The prayer of the day is found in your celebration sheet. It's under the title Collect of the Day. And we will pray that prayer together this morning. Please rise. Let us pray together. O God, your almighty power is made known chiefly in showing mercy. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we may be called to repentance and made partakers of your heavenly treasures. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. The psalm is the introit, in also on your celebration sheet. And I will read up to the asterisk, if you would please, as a congregation, complete each verse. O taste and see that the Lord is good. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his dwelling place. This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provisions. Satisfy her poor with bread. Her priests I will clothe with salvation. And her saints will shout for joy. Together, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. We'll have our first and second readings at this time from the Old Testament, Ezekiel 2, 1 through 5, and from 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 10. So you at home, Ezekiel 2, 1 through 5, and 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 10.
Okay, from Ezekiel 2, 1 to 5. He said to me, Son of man, stand on your feet, and I will speak with you. And as he spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard him speaking to me. And he said to me, Son of man, I send you to the people of Israel, to nations of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me, O Lord. I know a man in Christ for 14 years. Ago it was caught up in the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So you keep me from being intimidated by the surpassing greatness of the revelations. A thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harness me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, and it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This has been the word of our Lord.
The Holy Gospel today is from Mark 6, 1 through 13. I'd ask you all to please rise. Jesus went away from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him, and on the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue. And many who heard him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters living right here with us? And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household. And he could do no mighty work there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went about among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. And he charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and to not put on two tunics. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place won't receive you and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed them to the people. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. Here ends the gospel. Our next hymn, you may be seated, is number 376, Thine is the Glory. Number 376, and that's in the red hymnal, Thine is the Glory. For you at home, if you'd like to sing along in your hymnals, Thine is the Glory.
Thine is the glory, risen, conquering sun. Endless is the victory, thou o'er death hast won. Angels in bright raiment rolled the stone away, kept the folded grave cloths where thy body lay. Thine is the glory, risen, conquering sun. Endless is the victory, thou o'er death hath won. Lo, Jesus, meet thee, risen from the tomb. Lovingly he greets thee, scatters fear and gloom. Let his church with gladness hymns of triumph sing, for the Lord now liveth, death has lost its sting.
I was so surprised this morning when I came out of my office, a young man who I have known since he was, what would Hayden have been, four, is in church this morning. His name is Hayden Powell. But when Hayden was 4 years old, he had kind of a lisp. And we were having vacation Bible school at Bethany Lutheran in Dixon, and we had over 150 kids, and we had bales. We were outside, and we had a big bale wagon as our stage, and I was about to do the announcements when Hayden walked up to me, and he said, Pastor, can I talk in the microphone? And I thought he was going to be like all the other kids, hi, you know, so I gave him the microphone, and he turned and looked at me, and he said, Pastor, why do you wobble when you walk? I'll never forget. Why do you wobble when you walk? Anyways. My power is made perfect in weakness. The second reading today talks about how in weakness we have strength. Let us begin in prayer. O God, light of the minds that know you, life of the souls that love you, and strength of the thoughts that seek you, bless the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts. Breathe your life into us that we may live in the manner you have appointed unto us, and better love and serve you and one another. Amen. The story of Jesus' rejection in his hometown is a classic one. It's a story that most of us can identify with. I remember after being in seminary my first year, I went home to preach in Shaunavon. And as I was preaching, I was getting all fired up and into it. I looked out at the congregation, half the people were smiling. They weren't supposed to be smiling. It was a serious moment, but they were smiling because it was me preaching. And they were more in love with the fact that one of their own had been preaching than they were listening to what I was saying. But this is a story that we all can identify with. Often our families, our childhood companions, our husbands or our wives, well, they just fail to listen to the wisdom we have and accept the words of grace. My wife accepts almost nothing, I have to say, as wisdom. I can tell you that. And the people of our hometown, they know us too well. And therefore, they simply can't accept us. Now, Jesus didn't sin. He didn't sin as a child either. But many of us do. Isn't that the boy who got caught stealing a pen in the drugstore? Isn't that the kid that you know, threw a rock through some window, and now he's a preacher telling me how to live my life? Isn't that the kid who used to leave dirty socks laying around under the kitchen table at home? His mother used to always complain. Or the girl that used to skip school and go hanging out down at the cafe? Can these really be God's appointed instruments? The agent of God's healing and saving grace? I don't think so. And it's partly for this reason that the royal family of England strives so very hard to prevent too much detail about the private lives of the royals. And it's why even the littlest offense, the most normal offense that in normal life would be completely overlooked, sadly to say, something even like a divorce, in their world is a massive, massive tragedy and creates all sorts of news. They fear that the more that is known about them, the less effective they will be able to be representatives of the nations and the Commonwealth. Queen Elizabeth calls the royal quest for privacy not letting too much sunlight into the magic. In the TV series, The Royals, at the very point of the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II, it is true that someone nudged Winston Churchill and asked him, what is in the oil that is being poured on the Queen's forehead? And Winston Churchill turned and said, what's in that oil is pure magic. Consider the grumbling of the people in Jesus' hometown when he spoke to them. Where is the magic? So much so were they so disappointed in the fact that it was him coming to bring this message that he would not heal them, he would not do anything for them because they had no faith of any kind. Isn't this Mary's son? The brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Now, when you read in Scripture, you don't get all those emphasis, words emphasized so that you understand what they're saying, but aren't his sisters here with us? Who does this guy think he is? This kid used to make mud pies over there by the well. And the Scriptures go on to say that they took offense at him. And that, as a result, Jesus was unwilling. I don't like the translation was unable to do any miracles. He was unwilling to do any miracles there, except lay on his hands on a few sick people and heal them. Jesus rejected by his very own, and all because his own thought that they knew him. And of course, they had no idea who had been living among them. There we go. Too much sunlight had been let into the magic. In ministry, it has two sides. On the one hand, because of the way I am, people will sometimes connect with me because I speak very plain and I act very plain. Oftentimes, people who had nothing to do with the church are people that I get the closest to. But there's a flaw in that, because the people who are church people often reject that kind of thing in their pastor. I remember very well when I was a boy that pastors were almost always these very well-kept people who would have never, never come to church with a broken tooth, I can tell you that. And they always wore a suit and a collar and a shirt, and they always looked like they'd been sucking green lemons. They never smiled, and when they did, there was this cracking sound in their faces. And that was pastor. Scared me to death as a child. But as I say, there's many different ways to be accepted or rejected in ministry. And there is more to this story of rejection, because the story of Jesus' rejection by his villagers is also a story about how we ignore and reject God in our lives. It's a story about our unwillingness to be helped by God, or by anybody else for that matter. An unwillingness which comes out of our own certainties, I'm going to say out of our own vanities, out of our own conceitedness. There are people, and you know them, maybe you're one of them, whose pride is such that you just will not accept help. For the people who lived in Jesus' hometown, this man coming into their midst just messed around with all of that. We don't need this guy's help. We don't need this man's opinion. I certainly don't need his understanding of wisdom. Not from this guy, anyhow. But for most others, the grace of God is shut out because of that pride, because of that vanity. Not because they know Christ so well, but because they think they know what is best for themselves. They're so sure of themselves and so certain about all of the intelligence that they have that they don't listen. That their understanding, that their own strength is so great, but it gets in the way. The road to spiritual wholeness is not traveled by exercising our own human powers, but rather by acknowledging our own human weakness. I'm going to say it again. The road to spiritual wholeness is not traveled by all of the powerful gifts that you might have as a person, but rather by acknowledging your many failings. And then in that weakness, allowing God to enter in and exercise his power in us. Over the years, working as a prison guard, I was often involved with Alcoholics Anonymous. I volunteered. And every meeting had to have a guard present. And so I went to AA for 4 years, three nights a week, to listen to the people and talk and counsel and try to encourage. And members of Alcoholics Anonymous always amaze me. They really do. Good friends who attend probably understand the gospel better than most theologians. And indeed, better than most regular churchgoers. You would be amazed. They will tell you that the key to turning their lives around was when they finally could admit that there was nowhere left to go. When their weakness was so great that they simply could not put another foot in front of another to get away from it. They were crushed, powerless. Powerless over alcohol. I suppose that for me, that same assertion comes with being as fat as I am. There's a lot of similarities between being so heavy and being an alcoholic. Listen to the first three steps of the 12-step program. Number one, we admit that we are powerless over alcohol, food. That our lives have become unmanageable. Do you know that at one point I was 549 pounds? 549 pounds. We came to believe, number two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Number three, we made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God. In alcohol terms, higher power, as we understood him to be. And what we have here is, number one, an acknowledgement of weakness of need. Number two, a belief that God and only God can help. And number three, the willingness to turn the whole matter over to God and then just let him do his thing. As it is with alcohol, it is with the rest of life. Until we admit our weakness, until we admit that we are not in control of our world, that we are trapped by sin and we cannot free ourselves, and we really believe that until we stop being afraid of admitting that, we will never experience spiritual fulfillment. Joni Erickson. Her name is much more complicated than that. It's not Erickson. It's spelled weird, and then there's a Tade or something after it. I forget what it is. But Joni. I read her first book when I was long, long time ago, and it was just called Joni. I still have it in my shelf here. And Valerie and I spend a great deal of time listening to her. She is a quadriplegic. She cannot move her arms or her legs, and she is limited tremendously, but man, does that woman have a voice. She says this, "Believe me, my quadriplegia, my limitation, my wheelchair, these things are constantly reminding me that I am so weak and needy. I cannot do my disability on my own. On my own, I would die. I need help, and I need a lot of it. But maybe that's my secret to being strong in the Lord. People look at me and they think I'm strong and courageous in this wheelchair. But if this wheelchair has taught me anything, it's shown me that I am weak and I am poor and I am so needy." Listen, Jesus calls us to find courage in affliction, she says, to find perseverance in opposition. So friend, boast in your weakness, because you can't do it on your own. Let your limitations and needs show you how to cultivate the right kind of weakness, which always honors God. I mean, honestly, this is exactly why the Bible tells you to glory in your limitations and delight in your infirmities. Boast in Jesus, who although he was rich, became poor. Boast in Jesus, who although he was God, still hungered after righteousness for your sake. If you're feeling weak and needy today, boast in Jesus, the one who for your sake became utterly dependent and needy. He died in weakness so that you, dear friend, might have his strength today. When I look back at Hayden, he was my strength when I needed legs, when I was so heavy. He was my legs. We have to admit that we are broken, that we can't do it on our own. I went to seminary with a guy whose name, it wasn't this, but I can't remember what it was. I'll say Mark. He actually had come from another seminary, and he was taking classes with us. He had great gifts, but he couldn't get along with the other students. He was always fighting with us, always arguing theology, but doing it in such an aggressive fashion. Well, he made my aggressiveness look small. He always wanted to control the discussions in class. He always was ready with an answer to the questions asked by the teachers and the rest of us. And if his answer varied or differed from ours, well, his was the right one. When there was silence, he felt he had to fill it. When there was confusion, he tried to bring order. And not just any order, but his order. He never showed any hesitation or weakness to any of us. He never shared his personal problems and rarely left the room for us to share ours. And so as a result, we had a hard time liking him. One day, Mark was confronted with his behavior by a group of us students with a professor who were supposed to give Mark final grades that day. It was an interpersonal class, and there was communication and counseling involved, and we all gave each other grades. And when it came time for Mark's grade, well, he failed terribly. He went away, and we never saw him for a week. And later he returned with a piece of paper that explained it all, so he said. He claimed his father had never accepted him, that he had come from a broken home, and that people refused to look deeper into him. And that, yes, he was a little careless about sharing time with others and listening to them, but that he could get a grip on it if they just gave him a chance. The group of students recognized the sincerity in his paper. We all could see it, but we still refused to accept it. We rejected his answers, calling them inadequate and self-deceiving. I did the same thing this morning. John and I were talking in the back room, and I said to John, I said, I'm sorry for messing up last Sunday, but I've got this going on and this going on and this going on. Well, those are just excuses. You either get something done or you don't. Excuses, as my dad used to say, don't pay the bills. Well, at first Mark was dumbfounded. How could we be so thoughtless? He thought, I've poured my heart out in this letter. How could these guys not see that this is my passion, who I am? That he'd come up with reasons why he behaved like he did. And then he saw that the group wasn't buying it. And he grew frantic. He began to break down in front of us and he started to cry. And he said, I don't know what to do. I'm scared. I'm confused. What do you want from me? What can I do? Someone, please help me. I just feel so out of control. And at that point, everyone stood and went towards him, and he was embraced. It's okay, one person said, just cry. There's nothing wrong with being out of control. The truth is, we're all out of control. As a matter of fact, it's good that you finally have recognized it. Because now there is room for God to help you, to help bring control to your life, for God to find room inside of all of that vanity and all of that knowledge and boastiness that you have. And now there's room for us also to love you and show you who we are. And that we love you too, Mark. It changed him completely. He wasn't perfect, but he did become so much more sensitive to the needs of others. He no longer tried to run every situation. He actually listen to other people. We in turn began to know him better and became quite close. The Apostle Paul knew how that felt. Like us, he knew weakness. He had what he called a thorn in his flesh. Now there is every kind of explanation for that under the sun. Everything from it was migraine headaches all the way to he had a Jewish wife that would not convert and she was a constant thorn in his flesh. It just goes on and on and on, but most likely it had to do with some physical malady. And he prayed that it would be okay. From this point on, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness. that Christ's power might be seen all the greater within me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness, with insults, with hardships, with persecutions, and with difficulties. For when I am weak, God is strong. When I am weak, and weakness is despised above all things. The world teaches us to conceal our vulnerability, lest we be hurt. And as such, we are crushed by it. We are crushed by our weakness. We're too fat. We're too dumb. We're too this. We're too old. We're too something. And instead of letting God come into us and to allow others to see his strength shine through that weakness, we pout and act like children. And the world teaches us to camouflage our inadequacies with self-confidence, self-reliance, with self-assurance, with an awful lot of hair coloring. Which I always ask my wife to do because I'm not ready for her to get gray yet. This, my friends, is simply the way of the world. And it's not true in the eyes of God. It's the wisdom of the serpent who tempted Adam and Eve. It's not the wisdom of God. It was Eve who wanted to be like God. Adam wanted to know what God knows. And so they ate from the apple. That's the stuff of Satan, to want to be the biggest and the greatest and the most and the grandest and the most knowledgeable and on and on. And every alcoholic still hitting the bottle will tell you he can quit at any time that he wants to. And every dysfunctional person caught behaving in a way that is offensive to others tells you that they know better. And that they're on their way to licking the situation. And every really well-together Christian will tell you that they're in control of the sin in their lives. And they don't need anyone else to help them with it. Our weakness, our hardships, our tribulations are not of themselves a blessing. They are an opportunity for God to shine through us. Our weakness is a real problem, and it can create problems for how we get on with others. But when we acknowledge our weakness and our needs and turn to God, we find an amazing difference that comes upon us. When I am weak, then I am strong. If the truth be known, we are weak and broken in so many, many ways. And I'd like to tell you just a very short little story. The story is told about how one day a small boy was trying to lift a stone that was much too heavy for him. His father, walking by, seeing him struggle with the stone, said, "Son, are you using all your strength?" And the little boy said, "Well, yes, Daddy, I'm lifting with all my strength." When the father replied, "No, son, you're not, because you haven't asked me to help you." How much haven't we asked God to help us? The Civil War in the United States. And in conclusion, then, I'll read this poem for you. "I asked for help that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power, that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness, that I might feel the need of God. I asked for all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life, that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I asked for, but I got everything that I hoped for. Also, despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I am among all men most richly blessed. Amen. We will sing our next hymn, Did You Think to Pray? Did You Think to Pray? Most apropos. Folks, you at home can't hear the prayers now that we're about to do, so we'll sign off. I am going to be away on holidays for the next few weeks, so there will be no live stream from the church here. And so God bless you, and look for me again in August.